You are listening to WLUW 88.7 FM, broadcasting from the studios at Loyola University Chicago. Next up, our weekly installment of Heartland at Home with Michael James, Katy Hogan, and Thom Clark.
Hello, brothers and sisters, ladies and gentlemen, all you citizens of the world. Welcome to another edition of Heartland at Home. This is number 36 for the week of January 23rd. I'm Michael James here with Thom Clark and Katy Hogan, and it was Katy's birthday yesterday. And we are glad to be here again. We want to thank the New Radicals for their 90s hit, You Get What You Give, and it was used wonderfully in the inauguration show's Peace Parade Dance Across America. We're going to have a little bit later, we're going to have our state rep, currently our state rep, Kelly Cassidy, on. And we've got a lot of things to talk about. It's been a great week in America. We got a new president, and here we go. Good morning, Thom. Good morning, Katy.
Good morning, Michael.
Good morning, Michael.
It was quite an inauguration, wasn't it?
Really was.
I loved it.
I can't believe how good
it was. I got a little teary, I got to confess. I imagine you guys did, too. It wasn't something I intentionally did. I just all of a sudden was tearing up. It was a good feeling.
You know, can I explain the moment that, I mean, I cry regularly anyway. I don't keep track. I cry so regularly. It's easy for me. But I had it on, like you did, Thom, right from the point where you were watching that empty waiting helicopter for what's-his-face. And by the way, I never, ever saw as big a smile on the face of his bride as I saw yesterday.
She was
somebody's
so
happy to be leaving. I mean,
yes.
This week was that I was moving around my house with the coverage on my TV. So I wasn't staring at it when a woman's voice said, what's her name? Kamala Harris. Do swear. When those words came from a female's voice, I broke. That was it for me. The dam broke. And I wasn't even looking. It was the sound of a female voice saying those words. Now that I think about it, it was probably Maria Sotomayor's voice that started that I heard. Sorry for tripping around with that, guys. But
it's okay. It was a very moving time.
I wasn't expecting this, but at 7:05 a.m. I turned on the TV, still in my bathrobe, and yelled out a whoop that woke up the rest of the house when I saw the empty helicopter, because I didn't realize it was already leaving and that moment had arrived. And it was such an emotional relief. That was just my first tears, I guess of joy, but I think a lot of tension and other stuff that was oozing all day long. But boy, that I think part of what I was noticing is that the political class had a look over the brink a week or so ago and got really scared. And yesterday there was this desperate effort to crawl back to some kind of normalcy, which I don't think we'll have until we're all back and get vaccinated, amongst other things. But there was this moment where we could feel part of a whole rather than little pieces scattered all about, not being able to talk to each other. We'll see if that develops into something, but it was feelings that I hadn't expected. It was emotions as strong in terms of politics that I don't remember since McGovern lost to Nixon in 72. I was very involved with that campaign. We couldn't believe, not that he lost, but how badly he lost. And that kind of just deep emotion is sort of what I was feeling along with all the other grief in the past year. It's amazing how national rituals or liturgy might solve some things, although the military tone, I suppose not unexpected in a militarized city, was also very present and not surprising given the Biden family involvement with the military, but still I was a little wary of how much that was in display.
Wow, you know, you're all over the map there, Thom. I don't even know how to jump in. But I will attempt to jump in. because what you referred to was over a couple of weeks of happenings in our political life as Americans, and we have been yanked around, to be sure, in those last few weeks. But one of the things that I think we talked about before and that we will all be dealing with for a while is right after the assault on the Capitol by that small group of marauders, aided and abetted by whosoever within the complex, a lot of people on the other side of the fence were saying, okay, unity, okay, let's have unity. That became the big cry in response to my saying, okay, let's impeach the president for inciting a riot and insurrection and sedition and whatever else we can. And people were responding saying, come on, not time for a victory lap. I'm sorry, this is not a victory lap. This is taking care that no one ever thinks they can do that again. That's what it's about. And it's about, you know, preserving, to me, preserving for my non-existent grandchildren, but my nieces and nephews and their kids, the fact that we're on record saying this is not okay. So part of it is laying out a historical record that says the people who were looking around at this point woke up and said, no more, not this, not ever, you know?
You know, I grew up in Connecticut and there were reminders everywhere about the Revolutionary War. And I got to say, I was a very patriotic guy to the point of even when they would do the, the flag ceremony before a football game, I'd be getting all emotional holding my football helmet. And then I became pretty critical over the years of my government, but I never stopped loving the country. And I got to say, as much as I know there are battles and struggles and different positions that are going to be coming our way, that I felt really good about the potential for us again. And some of that was the words, Biden's words about, you know, become the nation that we can be or should be. Those kind of things really touched a string in my heart. And I I think we have to be joyous in the moment of our happy moment. Also get ready for the struggles that are going to come. And as you point to that, Katy, there are plenty of people calling for unity without mentioning accountability. And that's going to be on the agenda for many moons.
We also had just a lot of really good entertainment. I mean, our celebrity class turned out and they sounded and looked fantastic. Beautiful. But I got to give a lot of credit to a 22-year-old who, like the president, overcame a stutter to deliver one of the most amazing pieces of poetry and spoken word I've ever seen. It brought me right back to Robert Frost, who couldn't see, who was freezing at JFK's inauguration, couldn't read the script and ended up using a different poem from memory in that moment way back in 1960. She was something else. And I think that's part of the reason why we all got caught up in the day, particularly from that point on. The pageantry, the dancing in the streets was genuine, heartfelt, and exciting. Better than any halftime football show, if I may say.
When day comes, we step out of the shade, aflame and unafraid. The new dawn blooms as we free it. For there is always light, if only we're brave enough to see it, if only we're brave enough to be it.
Well, the poet is going to run for president someday by her own words. We'll see what that happens.
Well, she's got Oprah and a number of other powerful people in her corner. So look to see more of Ms. Gorman.
So one of the things that was amazing to me as the events unfolded was getting emails from overseas, almost instantly from German friends, from friends in London. There was this sense of relief and truly a new page being turned. These are friends and family who can't believe what we've been through the last 4 or 5 years, particularly German friends who just were seeing too many signs of the 30s showing up. And something, again, I think we need to be worried about going forward. One reason why I think we can't sweep accountability under the rug at this point, because we do need to get some truthiness on how we understand what's been happening. But I think the international reaction's been quite stunning.
People have been.
Katy? Sorry?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear what
you
said.
Did you have other international reaction or hear from other friends?
Of course I did, but I was not going to go that route because you just covered it. So I was going to go the route of how nice it was to see a working president this week who signed bills without using a Sharpie, yeah, without then showing us what he signed. a lot of activity right off the bat, undoing some really deleterious little missives that the previous occupant had delivered to us. So, for example, a halt to the wall, and I saw some coverage from the wall itself during inauguration day itself, where someone was saying, no activity. There's really nothing going on here. There used to be people building it, but no one showed up today. Also, I do seriously, though, one of the many serious issues facing the new administration is the place that we're in immigration wise, and the entire raft of reforms that we need to do. As we speak, there is in fact a caravan heading through Central America. And one of the pieces that I understand is part of President Biden's immigration work is to actually attend to the reasons why Hondurans are heading north. And it has everything to do with our policies back in the 80s, folks, yeah, with the Contras and arming people and using Honduras as our own private landing strip and army base or whatever. And those people are still suffering from our actions, our nation's actions. So watch for a much more thoughtful approach to problems like that, that take in the holistic nature, as opposed to just saying, oh, we've got foreigners on our doorstep.
I'd just like to note in passing that, you know, we've rejoined the Paris Accords. The Keystone Pipeline is being canceled. All the EPA rules that got diluted are being reviewed. There are deep tentacles of the previous administration's efforts to deregulate stuff in the Labor Department, in the Transportation Department, all of which were addressed in some of those executive orders yesterday to begin relooking and going back on some of those regulatory changes.
Hey, Michael? did you guys hear about that security guy that Trump tried to saddle Biden with?
Yeah.
And Biden put him on leave, like, yes, within 5 minutes of being inaugurated. Yeah, it's like, yeah, Joe, you're out of here. Bye-bye.
You know, it was great, the bold moves that Biden made right away. And immigration is right at the forefront, as you guys have been talking about. It'll be a challenge. I mean, you know, I don't know if we're going to see a quick reversal on the part of some of those Republicans to give us the votes we need, but it's going to be a struggle, I think.
I like the way that, I'm sorry for interrupting.
No, it's all right.
I like the way that there was immediate response. This is so unequal, the way this happens. But anyway, immediate response from the people who have been funding a lot of politicians decided to cut off funds to the lawmakers who objected to the election results. They have just lost a whole ton of their biggest PAC givers, which is great, but, you know, raises more questions than it answers, because of course we need to overthrow Citizens United, or we'll never get the kind of people in the Congress we need. Or
I think the question still is, why are these people even giving money to these guys?
Exactly. You know?
I mean, I don't want to have to think about who owns every shop I go into, but I do that. you know, we'll see if they change, if it there's some places we can go into now or places we still won't go into, but it'll be something to look at.
Something that hasn't been talked about much that I think will be an intriguing battle to see in the split Senate, whether any kind of joint operating agreement can be negotiated between McConnell and Schumer. There's there's this issue of the filibuster. And as a political scientist, it's something that doesn't get talked about much. But I really think if we're going to take seriously throwing off what we've learned in this Black Lives Matter, coming to grips with equity issues, the remnant of Jim Crow era of this country, where the filibuster was used to stymie virtually every progressive move to bring some semblance of human rights to this country, might be good enough reason to finally kill the filibuster. It's something that, depending who's in office, they really hate giving it up. But it is the cudgel that's being used right now by McConnell to, you know, basically force a 60 vote rather than a 50 plus one vote majority. And I think it's something we ought to seriously look at and discuss as an important structural reform to throw off the past.
You know, we host producers meet regularly and talk about what we're going to do on the show. And one of the things that, Thom, you keep bringing up are looking around the corner at what's coming up, what's next. And you have a long list. You want to share a few of those with us before we go to a musical break?
What did you just ask him for, Thom, Michael? I didn't hear that.
I thought that some of the issues that we've been discussing here might be better dealt with not in the courtroom, but in front of some kind of truth commission that might look at a whole bunch of questions both sides of our divided country may have about what's happened the last 30 years, so that we have a clearer sense about the path forward if we're all going to be somehow unified and fulfill our country's promise.
Well, since Thom claimed himself as a political scientist, I am too. I'm going to claim myself as a political scientist because I did get one degree in that. I do not think that leaving it to the elected political leaders is the way to deal with either the what were you just talking about, the filibuster or the redistricting. No elected official wants to be told about, redistricting, redrawing lines. Once they're elected, they're all of a sudden not wanting to talk about. Once they're elected, they don't want to talk about removing the filibuster. Like you just said, Thom, those in power like to use it. So my thing, like your thing, is this truth and reconciliation process, which I think is absolutely needed. I would like also for there to be a citizen's lobby, you know, with as much power and might, even if it doesn't have the bucks, as some of these other lobbyists who crowd up the halls of Congress and state houses all over the country. We have to figure out a way that citizens can be effective lobbyists and be taken seriously. The only people who take us seriously are the people we elect at this point, not the people who are elected by the big PACs. So everything going forward hinges on getting overturned Citizens United, as far as I'm concerned.
I don't disagree.
As start for starters. Love that song, and I love that Jean-Baptiste chose that to be his homage to the inauguration festivities. And I'm so sorry that my phone keeps ringing. We'll explain why in a minute. Lift Every Voice, that is also known as the Black National Anthem. So enjoy. We did have other good news this week, and that is there is a vaccine. And Michael, talk to us. I think you're the first one to have a needle in your arm.
I did have a big, long needle in my arm, and I have a healthcare provider that I'm hooked up with. And I had a meeting with my nurse practitioner on Tuesday, and I told someone from their office that, sure, I'd take the vaccine. Next thing you know, yesterday I'm watching the TV like all of us were, getting emotional. And the next thing I know, this call comes in and says, do you want to get the vaccine? Can you come right over? And they came and picked me up and they took me in. I talked to the doc a little bit, and he was actually another nurse practitioner. And I think what was going on was they had an open case of the vaccine and they had to use it up by 5 o'clock.
Interesting.
And they were calling people in the in their stable of clients, and I was a lucky one. So I got it, and I tell you what, I got a really sore arm, but my spirits are pretty high. And I've had a number of people responding to the announcement I put up on Instagram and Facebook wanting to know where I got it, how they get it. So I'm not going to share all that information, but I will in private.
Well, I think the lesson there is call your healthcare provider, which is what I did. And he couldn't help me because his practice is going to be too small to get vaccines. But he also couldn't refer me to my local hospital, where the same thing. I'm 8 minutes away. If they have leftover stuff at the end of the day, I'm willing to get a shot, but I'm not on a list. And as he put it, I can't believe how uncoordinated this is. We all expected to know more at this point. I did discover, though, that the city now has a list. COVID Coach is a place where you can sign up and you will get information and email alerts when the vaccine becomes available. Right. It does appear that by March, there will be pretty regular vaccines available, at least at city colleges in the city of Chicago. But it does also appear as if your doctor, maybe your local hospital, has supplies beginning to increase, and you should be in touch with them so that you can get on a list.
Hey, my brother and his wife got their vaccine started at a Jewel last week on the Southwest side. So
I've been boycotting Jewel ever since the farm workers and the grape strike.
Amazing that you're still walking, Michael. So yeah, COVID, for those, all these three faces, and we've been criticized for this by some of our listeners, we're all old people, so we do need the vaccine. And a couple of us have pre-existing conditions. So I thought it was fascinating that one of the West Coast governors, was it the California governor, approached Starbucks because Starbucks is on every corner and yep. distributes stuff regularly. I felt the same way at the start of this when they were talking about how to get things around. I thought, well, why not ask Amazon? You know, if you called Amazon, they'd have a vaccine at your doorstep tomorrow. I'm sorry, I shouldn't be making fun of it because it's life-saving, and I
no,
will.
But Amazon actually reached out to be helpful. I mean, that's in addition to the Starbucks, Amazon. Who knows how they're going to do it? But I think we'll see an improvement in the distribution of the vaccine. Let's hope so.
Well, the new president immediately did what should have been done 9 months ago, and he called on the national, whatever they call it, act, recovery, whatever act, to get certain manufacturers in the game. This is something that should have been done 1 year ago, which is right now we're marking a year since the first local U.S. death of COVID, and we now have 400,000. Moment of silence, my God.
Well, how about a little more talk about the vaccine? Here in Chicago, there's talk about relaxing rules around restaurants, bars, and all that kind of thing. Your take on that? Any information?
I don't like it. I'm not going to be comfortable eating inside with strangers for quite a while, much less drinking. And I don't think it's wise. Lori Lightfoot does not need to do that. She's got a good ally in Pritzker, keeping his foot on the brake in the places it should be, and she should work with him on that.
I think the pressure is clearly humongous, because we already have restaurants, particularly in the surrounding suburbs, who've been violating the state mandates. And I think that's one of the biggest fears, is if they reopen restaurants at what, 20% capacity, who's going to be watching whether they're actually are doing 50% or 75%? And it's pretty clear from the early tracking, which of course is not well done because this was not well planned by anyone. Restaurants were cited as the number one or number two place that people think they contracted the infection back in spring and summer. So the data right we have home. Suggests that opening early, while it will be a relief to restaurant workers, may not be safe to the public. And like opening schools too early, why don't we wait until we get more of us vaccinated and be and patronize our restaurants with takeout, which we do a couple of times a week to try to keep those folks alive. It's hard for all of us, but we cannot afford another uptick, folks.
Thom, you have a grandson who is a Chicago public school student, or will be. And so what is your actual take on that? Because the teachers union is up against the mayor around the reopening of the schools.
Well, the media likes to frame this as parents and students being caught between the teachers and the mayor. And I think that's the wrong way to look at it. I actually think the CTU is not only standing up for the rank and file teachers, but also students and families who are very concerned, as our household is, that it's not time yet to co-mingle students, even if they don't get infected, for what they may bring home to the rest of us. And to be honest, I don't think our frontline teachers should be exposed, particularly if they have extenuating circumstances, to that kind of danger. We are not vaccinated enough for this to be a safe time to reopen schools.
I want to insert something here because some of the interrupting phone calls that were appearing on my computer as we're on our Zoom are from potential candidates who are calling me. And so if we succeed, what will happen on this Zoom radio show shortly is we will be talking to our familiar to you listeners, State Representative Kelly Cassidy, because the biggest local news this week in our neck of the woods was a shakeup of our very local elected state officials, namely that the state senator Staines was to step down. And it appears that State Representative Kelly Cassidy wants to step up into that spot, which means then we would have an opening. So we'll talk about this more, but I just want to warn you, in case we actually do get a phone call, we're going to probably shoot it in here somewhere to ask Kelly some questions if she deigns to come back and answer. So we weren't sure, but we're so happy that you did find time to join us today, you busy person, you. First of all, I want to say, welcome to the new world.
I know.
Yes, all of that.
It's amazing. And we you didn't hear it, but we talked a lot about all of that and inauguration and how it made us feel and that young woman with her poetry and it all.
The firefighter signing the pledge, like I was holding it together pretty well. And at that moment, like for whatever reason, that's the part where I just, I got cracked.
What was that part again? Describe
the firefighter who led the Pledge of Allegiance, but did it in ASL.
Oh God, I loved that. I loved that. Yeah.
And like, I had it together. I was staying calm. I was just, you know, and
hey, you know what? Why do we call it having it together when we should be emoting? I mean,
it's
really.
True.
Okay, so for a lot of us here in Chi-Town and in our neck of the woods, the biggest local news this week was the shakeup upcoming of our very local elected officials. And with the announcement that Senator Heather Staines, who we actually were calling to get on this show for the last month or so before the veto session. Anyway, she has decided to step down. And of course, you as one of the representatives of half of her district, her Senate district, are definitely in line. And you have stated that you are interested in being appointed. Is that the correct way to say it?
Yes, I am seeking the appointment to the vacancy created by Senator Staines with her resignation.
All right. So, not like you haven't had too much to do lately between an in the gymnasium veto session, right, which resulted in, I think, one of the more historic criminal justice reform pieces ever. And hopefully it's going to be signed by our governor soon. Then of course, we had a Capitol break-in. And since you were hanging around in a Capitol, you probably had a little bit of anxiety about that. Yeah. And then, of course, we all got to experience the inauguration, which does, in fact, feel like a new day. Mm-hmm. At the same time, this news came out about the shakeup. So can I first ask, wasn't it just this time last week where you were being considered one of the people that could, in fact, replace Madigan as the chair of the chairman?
Yes, that was. There were a lot of folks speculating about that, and I think, like, I guess it's natural to speculate that since I've been one of the primary critics. But you know, I was not seeking the seat. I never sought the seat. You know, I was merely one of the 19 that were, you know, united around the goal of getting a new speaker.
That's right.
Yeah. As we saw, like, even the 19 didn't stick together as the candidates, you know, came and went, because that was never our mission. Our mission was simply to bring about change.
Yeah. And how do you feel about that process?
Was grueling. It was really, it was very interesting. And as I talked to friends in legislatures around the country who were asking what was going on, knowing, you know, my involvement in it, and I would say to them, we haven't had a contested speaker's race since 1975, and their heads would explode.
Right.
Because, like, we're it. Nobody else does this. Somebody told me that the next closest to us is only, like, we were 37, 38 years of his run, and the next closest state is like 15 or something years that their speaker has served.
Yeah.
And so in every other state but ours, this process is normalized. This process is you know, quite routine and doesn't cause all of the kerfuffle that this one did. And so if nothing else, I'm hopeful that, you know, the muscle memory will begin to form around how to have these kinds of conversations and come out the other side united. And you know, I'm hopeful on that front.
Well, it's you face a similar across the aisle challenge, right? Mm-hmm. At various times, it's been more acrimonious than others. Right now, it seems relatively peaceful, at least at the moment.
Yeah, I think that, you know, I think there might be a little honeymoon.
Right.
But, you know, there's a lot to get done, and this budget's going to get really, really hard, really, really fast.
Yeah.
And I think that that we won't necessarily see on that front, just because we're going to have to get down to some tough discussions really fast.
Given that Heather was actually, wasn't she on the budget committee and very active in helping?
She was.
Those discussions?
Yes, she was. And they were changing the way the budgets were being done.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not certain what her role was going to be in this new General Assembly in that regard. Obviously, you know, the institutional memory is there, and that's a huge loss. She is an expert at a section of the budget and a segment of the law that is really arcane and very hard to master.
Well, you bring up one of the things that those among us who deep thoughts about this often worry about. Frankly, and that is the memory, the very valuable lessons learned by people who have experienced this, who are not necessarily in the elected official business to line their pockets. In other words, our representatives.
Yeah.
And they're very precious to us. So I guess that's also why you heard about it before we did. When did you hear that this change was on the horizon, by the way?
I actually didn't. She and I talked. She told me she was going to do it soon. Somebody sent me the tweet. That was how I learned that she had actually submitted her letter.
A very 2020 of us.
Exactly.
Well, that's cool. That's good. I understand that. Yeah.
You know, the day, you know, that day and the day before that, you know, she had made a decision. It was sort of a funny moment of, you know, somebody sent, and I was like, oh, okay, here we go.
So here's the question that I warned you. You do understand, I know you understand that what people, how people feel, recognize that voters feel a little bit taken when an elected official who they just elected in November steps down literally the same week that they took the oath of office for that newest session. How are we to make sense of that as voters? Is there any progressive interpretation that can be given? I'm used to this because, well, I've been doing politics a long time, but some people
are. Yeah. Right. And you know, fundamentally, if you think about it, you start running, like, we're going to get petitions in the fall for the March primary of 2022, the November general of 2022 to be installed in 2023, right?
Right.
And so you start, you commit very, very early, earlier than most people, I think, realize. So that's one piece of it, you know, yeah. Your life.
Timing.
September of a year. Yeah. And, you know, fundamentally, I know that, you know, we are held to a higher standard and we should be, but we are also still humans who have complex lives, and things sometimes go sideways in our lives and we can't always predict. And so I'm going to respect Heather's personal space and acknowledge that, you know, the decision is made based on the totality of her life. And, you know, that is why we have, you know, the other piece of this, like here on the North side, and Katy, you've participated in this. We do things differently than the state even requires us to, in terms of how we do these replacements. You know, I think that a lot of folks would be shocked. You know, when I sought the appointment and you know, faced, was it 25 of us, 26 yes. of us? There was a lot. It was a healthy crowd.
There were quite a big few of us. But the thing is, but I know what you're saying, Kelly, and that's good. Yeah. And we all hold out hope to maintain a record of doing things only better and better and more transparent and, you know, more with equity, et cetera, because I don't want to, you know, base ourselves, you know, on the low bar that has, right. you know, typically been Illinois, much less Chicago politics in other parts of our area. So we will miss Heather because she is darn good. And she's been in there for what, 11 or 12 years,
I think 12 years.
Is it a year longer than you? Because you've been around 11 in the.
No, I came in 11. I'm going on my 10th year. So in May 16th will be my 10th anniversary.
Okay. All right. So without over dwelling on it, because we've got to talk about a couple other things. What is the process? You have indicated you're open to being considered. And I already talked to you about getting calls from people locally who want to be considered for your seat. So yeah. What is the actual ABC process? Because Heather is going to step down, I guess, at the end of the month, January 31st.
Yeah, so state law requires that the committee men or committee people of the party of the person leaving convene and choose. And their power in that negotiation, each committee person's power in that negotiation, is comparative to their the percentage of the vote in that race. So first there will be, and literally, like, if this wasn't a Northside seat, they could jump on the phone and be like, which one of you has a captain that wants to go down? In this case, I'm guessing it will look a lot more like what we've seen in the past or on the North side. And the committeeman with the highest percentage is the convener of that call meeting process.
How many of you are there? I know you're a main committeeman of that district, but how many others?
It runs down from Evanston all the way down into the 46th ward. And sort of wraps around a little bit. So it will be Eamon Kelly, myself, but I'll, recuse and have a proxy from the organization. Eamon Kelly, myself, Harry Osterman, Paul Rosenfeld, Maggie O'Keefe, Sean Tenner, a little bit of 33 and 39. So that's Ram Vilavalam and Iris Martinez, and 50, a little bit of 50 as well. Each of them having, like, you know, single digit percentages.
None of 40?
Yes, Maggie O'Keefe from 40.
Well, Maggie, she's the... right, okay. Well, that's quite a crowd.
It is, it is. When compared to the House District, which is, you know, a little bit of Maggie, mostly me and Harry and Eamon, it's a very different makeup. We have a very unique district, this House District. It's
You're gonna suddenly have a very different bunch of people. And I know you've often said right on these airwaves how much you love representing the 14th. It's gonna be a kind of a difference to go, you know, incorporating the 7th, all the people in the 7th, right?
Yeah, it is. It is. It's also, that's an exciting challenge as well. So
you're up to it.
But I do, I genuinely, and like, as you talked about hearing from people who are interested, first of all, I would say to anyone who is contemplating it, start from the fact that there isn't a vacancy in the 14th yet. So you have a minute, take a breath, because the first process will be around the 7th. And then I would resign and there would be a vacancy. There's no vacancy to contemplate technically until I resign.
Yeah. But you know,
right.
But the way we all are,
whether or not, you know, it's just my Irish superstition here. It's just, the reality is there are steps between here and there. So folks have a minute.
That's very good.
That's what I mean about that.
That's very good. I'll tell you the other thing that I really appreciate about Heather Staines has always been her, thanks to her historic family attachment and engagement with South Side, West Side, she's been such an incredibly great representative for us who care about Black Lives Matter issues, who care about equity issues. I think she's been really useful in that way. And I will miss her so much for that as a person who looks like me, but really knows a lot more.
Yeah, I gotta say, it's very unusual to have the kind of relationship with your senator that I have with Heather. Mm. There are a lot of seated pairs, if you will, that don't get along, that don't like each other is.
Yeah.
And even those that do get along well, they look at us and are blown away. Like, we finish each other's sentences, you know? I absolutely will miss her as well.
So let's just, before we let you go on this wonderful afternoon where we both deserve to see a little bit of the sun that's shining. Couple things. One,
so I'm looking forward to getting a minute outside.
Yeah, exactly. When will equity cannabis license seekers get some relief? Anytime soon, do you know?
So I am part of the cannabis working group. There was an attempt to do another trailer bill that once again failed, just as we tried in May to make some repairs to the system, and it collapsed under its own weight. Same thing happened in this cycle. The intent was to create a second bite at the apple for those that got left out of this lottery.
Right.
It's impossible to retroactively do anything about the folks that are in the lottery.
Got it.
Right. That is in the court. That's in the hands of the courts. The courts are working that out. Whatever that comes to is it's going to come to. But what we were contemplating, what we were referring to as like 1A, you know, round 1A, where the folks who didn't get into the lottery would have an opportunity without additional fees, without any, you know, any other harm coming to them to get into a lottery for another 75 licenses. With the idea being that those licenses would likely hit the street before the set that is tied up in litigation.
Gotcha.
So I suspect the effort will be very quick to try to very quickly pass that in the new session. In some ways, during the lame duck session, we ran out of runway. And so it did.
A couple other things. Should we make anything of the news that former Speaker Madigan has moved out of his Springfield apartment?
So the
This is a Thom question.
I know, totally. The scuttlebutt on this is simply that because he's not speaker, he's not going to be there very much and he doesn't need to keep an apartment. And I will say that a lot of my colleagues are giving up their apartments because it's unclear how much we're able to be here. In some cases, there are folks that share apartments and we can't do that. There are a lot of other folks who are also giving up their apartments. So it is possible that is legitimate.
So while the Black Caucus and other representatives achieved a great legislative success with the aforementioned criminal justice bill reform, CTU got expanded bargaining rights, but the House did not approve elected school boards. And
the House didn't have to. The House already has.
Oh, who was? The Senate.
Yeah.
And will they, or did they turn it down?
Well now we're gonna have to start all over again.
Okay. Did the mayor do very well with her program in Springfield, do you think?
To be honest with you, I was a little consumed with what was going on with the speaker's race and helping with the pillars. So I don't have a great read. I know that there was, the one thing I did engage in, to the expanded collective bargaining rights, there was some unintended consequences of that language, and there was an agreed trailer bill to take care of that. And I ended up carrying that sort of at the last minute. So just to make sure that there's nothing, that it could be implemented, frankly. So
you kind of rock that way, Kelly. We agreed that earlier in this show, before you were joined us, that we think that Mayor Lightfoot pushing to open bars and restaurants might be a little premature. Do you have any feelings about that? I know she's getting a lot of pressure. And as a restaurateur, I totally get it.
It's so hard to thread the needle. As someone who is so, I've always been really strongly supportive of the hospitality industry. And I know what, in particular, those represent those small businesses that keep neighborhoods alive, right? Like the Heartland was not just a restaurant. So I get the pressure, and I get that these guys aren't gonna survive. And so finding a way to thread the needle, but I wouldn't eat inside if I had to right now.
Neither, yeah. Are you in Springfield right now because you have to quarantine?
Yeah. There were multiple cases in the Bank of Springfield Center. We learned on our last day of session where folks really didn't take advantage of the testing capacity that was available. Mm. I got to every day. There were several of us who did. And the folks from the lab that were down there were like, you guys are the only ones we're seeing. Nobody's, they were complaining they were bored. And then on the last day, just over half of us tested on the last day even. And there were four cases detected that day, including the speaker's chief of staff, which was very concerning for many of us, myself included, because we were in very close proximity to her. I mean, we had a 20-hour day on the floor, some of that time spent in an even smaller room because we had meeting rooms downstairs that were closed. And I don't trust indoor ventilation.
No, I don't do indoor clothes. No.
Yeah. So that was a disconcerting moment. And I have tested again. I'm waiting for results. We've got a lot of health issues in my family that I can't risk getting other people sick. I have underlying conditions. And so it's really this, trying to balance being here to keep everyone safer, because I at least have an apartment where I can take care of myself. But if I get sick, I'm alone. But going home, my kid's other mom has literally no immune system. Our housemate is over 60 and has underlying conditions. I'm erring on the side of caution and missing my family terribly, but I am.
So let's end on a positive note, because that inauguration celebration moved so many of us in so many ways, but the resulting feeling for me is one of possibility.
Yeah.
In addition to exhaling for maybe the first time fully in 4 years. Is there any particular thing that you woke up with after the new day happened?
I mean, in so many ways, it's still kind of sinking in. Like you talked about finally exhaling. Like I do feel like I watched the entire inauguration holding my breath. Like still not believing it's real, still not believing something bad isn't going to happen, you know? And I'm here a block from the Capitol, less than a block from our Capitol, that was surrounded by, you know, military vehicles and armed soldiers, and my morning walk involved talking to these soldiers every day. And so there was this bizarre split brain experience happening as I watched it, and, you know, going out for a walk the next morning and then being gone. That was kind of cool. And you know, the boards coming down off of our Capitol, like when, the day they were boarding up the Capitol, like I every time I heard the power guns going off, I cried.
Yeah.
Like it just, so I think I'm still exhaling. I think I'm still clenching. I think a lot of us are still unclenching.
I'm sure so many of us are still. It's been too long, and we've built up an incredible apparatus that whatever we needed to deal with it all, each of us individually. Yeah. But I do think it's going to be an interesting thing for all of us to track as we open up. Mostly, yeah. I want us to think of the things that we can do to make the world a better place for all of us.
I mean, honestly, simply having empathy and kindness emanating from the White House.
Yes.
Is revolutionary,
right?
Like seeing them, like when they you know, she put her head on his shoulder and he kissed her, and it was just that moment of, oh wow, the first family likes each other. Yes. How weird!
Right. No, it's a new day. It's a new day, and
I think that we're gonna have.
Yeah. Well, my partners who are invisible right now, but we all thank you very much for giving us some time out of your Springfield afternoon, darling.
Thank you.
We'll follow these changes with you as they unfold.
Thanks a lot. Good to see you.
Yeah, likewise, darling. The other thing that I wanted to remind people is that we are also, as we look to a new world, and we should be looking to a new world as a result of this inauguration. But here locally, people need to remember that we have a consent decree to help shape a new tomorrow for policing in Chicago. Nothing could be more important than that to certain of the communities in Chicago. And for those of us who want to support communities of color, the best way we could do this is to learn about the consent decree and become aware of the ways to be active on that front. And I'm going to suggest a way, because Network 49, our local independent political organization, is in the best position to help folks through that, because Network 49 is one of the Campbell plaintiffs in that event. So January 30th, there's going to be an event that we'll announce later in the show as well. But here locally, there'll be a Zoom event from Network 49. And we'll keep you posted on where to find that invitation. It's on Network 49's page.
We also talk a lot about environmental degradation and parts of the city that seem to suffer more than others about that. But we have some good news on this front. One of our recent guests, Marjorie Frisbee, who's executive director of Friends of the Chicago River, had a really fascinating report this week after 15 years of championing the cleaning up of Bubbly Creek near Bridgeport. She announces that project, pending additional funding, is actually really moving along well. If we can fix Bubbly Creek, she said, we can fix anything. And that's really true. This is the part of the Chicago River, if you don't know, where the slaughterhouses dumped all their remains going back decades. So it's truly a stew of a mess that needs to be cleaned up.
Ooh, yuck. Yeah, that is good news. And that's really some of the best news. The hardest jobs we have to do, folks, are the ones we have to do. Speaking locally, I just love that Rogers Park Business Alliance, the local caretaker of small businesses in our neighborhood, has chugged along, God love them, through this COVID time, supporting local businesses. And I want to just remind anyone listening that if you are a Rogers Park or near to Rogers Park resident and you want to support local businesses, check out the Rogers Park Business Alliance website and their sign up for their local catch-up sends, because they're full of information and they're really supportive of the local businesses. So just reminding you of that.
Katy, do you have a joke of the day?
Do I? I mean, I thought it was about, you know, not using a Sharpie. To sign presidential things and holding them up to the camera to say, look what I did. But no, do you have a joke, Michael?
I don't have a joke. I do have a little sports report if you want it, though.
Lay it on us.
Well, we've seen athletes really ascending to the top of the be good kind of people in the world. And they've played a real role. We have this outgoing, this gone president who really fostered the cultural wars and badmouth Colin Kaepernick. And it just was a real negative guy. And what we're going to see now is a return of athletes who, when they win a championship, going to the White House. That's already been signaled by Green and LeBron James. Green's first name is Draymond. And I think this will be good, because once again, it was the Women's National Basketball Association that really took a stand against the Georgia Senate race, bringing us Warnock now. And I think we're going to see a lot more athletes making good moves and going to the White House. One thing Biden did was to congratulate the names, I'm going to get them right, Sue Bird and Megan Rapinoe on their engagement. And we like Biden, we like athletes, and we're glad that the kind of way good athletes have been treated is no longer.
So the major message now, as we shift in our consciousness from what it has been, we should really pay attention to how this all shakes out. But I'm trying to get on a forward path, and that means back into activism, where we're actually trying to lay down some rules for living better in the future. One of those comes up this week, the nuclear power and weapons, the connections between the two, is a Zoom, of course, session that NCIS, Nuclear Energy Information, that's nuclear NEIS, webinar featuring the author of Carbon Free, Nuclear Free, Dr. Arjun Makhjani. That's our friends at NEIS, and look for Nuclear Energy Information Service to get on that Zoom invitation. And the other event that I mentioned a little earlier is the next community gathering of Network 49, featuring their special guest, Alderwoman Maria Haddon, which is going to be very interesting given the other information I shared with you earlier, as well as it's her birthday, so we're going to do a whole birthday thing there. And that'll be, like I said, January 30th, next Saturday.
11. But happy birthday to Maria and to Katy and to a whole bunch of other January birthdays.
Paige James' wife, turns.
And Inez Mendoza.
There's a lot of January birthdays. We'll keep you next week. We'll have more birthdays for you.
Yes. Keep doing that.
Okay, so we want to thank you all for tuning in to this version of Heartland at Home. We are broadcast every Saturday morning on WLUW 88.7. You can find us on Facebook. You can find us on CAN TV on a regular basis now. And we want to encourage you all to continue to do good in the world.
The world needs all the good we do.
All power to the people.